Good evening and welcome to Inside Your District. My name is Marcia Goodman Hinnershitz and I'm proud to be the City Councilor for District 2, which also is affectionately known by a lot of folks as East Reading. So tonight we have some special guests with us that we're going to be talking about visiting the past of East Reading and moving to the future. So I'd like to introduce my guests, Tom Gajewski, who's a former county commissioner and a former resident of East Reading.
And city councilman, too.
And city councilman, that's true. But at that point, we didn't have the councilman divided by district. You were at large.
Right.
And also, Pat Mock. Mm-hmm. One of the unique things about Pat is I'm found that she lives on the same street that I live now.
Yes,
South
I did.
15th Street.
Uh-huh.
So just a little bit of why we're here tonight. We're going to be talking about a great celebration that's coming up in the summer, an East Reading reunion, and how that all got started. And as we talk about that, we're going to talk about the things that were the past of East Reding and the things that we want to look at in the future. So just for a little bit of self-disclosure, as we were getting ready to go on air, I was just sharing where we lived and how long we lived. So I've been on South 15th Street, 564 South 15th Street, since I married my husband for 35 years. So Tom, a little bit of where you were from.
I lived at 1215 Cotton Street for 23 years when I moved away, and we moved to the northwest section of Reading at that time, uh-huh, into a bigger house.
Okay.
And I lived on South 15th, 529, right next door to the fire hydrant. Told everybody, you know, up the hill, go to the fire hydrant. Now we live next door, and I was there until I was born there, and I moved out when I was 30 and moved to the country.
So I guess the first question is, why a reunion? Why is that so important? We talk about East Reading, too, and I want to be able to define what that is, but I think, Tom, you're the one that got it started. Why are we having a reunion?
Well, the way it really got started was I have the privilege of serving on the Southern Junior High School / Middle School Alumni Association Board, and we decided to do a reunion of Southern. And we did that. We did a breakfast reunion at Wyomissing Family Restaurant. And then, I want to give credit where credit's due, Shirley Novotarsky, who used to have a beauty shop on South 18th Street, said, why don't we expand this? We all had friends who went to Central.
Mm-hmm.
And did you go there, Pat?
No, I went to Reading High.
Okay, but we have a lot of people now that went to Central. Why don't we get everybody together from East Reading? So that was the seed that got all this started, and then I guess it was back in mid-February, Sandy Lubos Hummel and I got together for a luncheon meeting and decided, well, yes, we're going to do this, and thanks to good people like Pat and yourself, we're moving forward with a reunion, and we have the date picked of Sunday, September 16th, and it's at the Liederkranz from noon to 6.
Okay. And how did you get involved, Pat, with the reunion?
Actually, my sister called me and she said, hey, did you see in the newspaper? And I don't get the newspaper. I'm sorry, Reading Eagle. I don't get the newspaper. Mm-hmm. But she said, do you want to go? And I said, sure, why not? And that's how we got involved. I mean, it was our neighborhood as well.
Yeah, sure, exactly. Sure. And what's really great about that whole section is it's still a strong neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
We might have seen changes of who lives there, mm-hmm, but the people that live in what I still call East Reading, because that's how it was introduced to me. And by the way, before my husband and I moved there, I actually had a lot of friends that lived in that section. And from the time I was in high school, I sort of knew all about Cotton Street, what was traditionally known as the Cotton Street Run.
Mm-hmm.
You guys want to say anything about that? What was the Cotton Street Run?
I don't know.
You don't know?
No.
The bus run.
The bus run. How about the bar run?
Well, that too. There was a bar, I believe, on every corner.
Yeah.
Right.
And I know my dad used to go down to Boo Boo's every Friday night and then stagger home after drinking and playing pinochle.
Yeah. So there was always a lot of social activities. Now we have a lot of grocery stores, bodegas. Mm-hmm. But Cotton Street's always been a business district.
Mm. Yes.
Mm. Okay, a lot of activity. And the one tradition we still have there is Tax Sandwich Shop, which will soon probably be going under new ownership.
Oh.
Okay. With Josh Narotowski, who runs Rita's Ice out in Mount Penn, is working together with Greg Tack and Charlie and such. But it's still there, and it's still, you know, a thriving sandwich shop. So one of the things we know is there's a lot of pride in the neighborhood.
Yes.
A lot of pride of things that go on, and people have good memories of the past, but I think a lot of new memories are being made, too.
Well, and East Reading, to me, and I, you and I have talked about this, Pat, it's really kind of like an extended family.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
It's not like, you know, we're just neighbors. We care about each other. We helped each other. And if we got, as kids, if we got into some sort of trouble and the neighbors saw it, they would scold us, but then they'd call our parents, and so it was.
You'd get it doubly.
Yeah,
right?
exactly. But that's the way it was. But it really generated a lot of special memories.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, there were like activities that you looked forward to.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to talk a little bit about that. I mean, we are really blessed with Neversink Mountain on one side, Mount Penn on the other.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but the pagoda is, you know, our favorite icon. But we have a lot of good parks and playgrounds and a lot of things. So can you talk about some of the memories, the things you enjoyed as a child?
One of the things that came to mind was the lantern parade from Neversink Playground.
Uh-huh.
You know, you went up and you sat underneath the little gazebo kind of thing there, and you had your aide there, and they told you this is how you're going to make. And we carried the candles in the lantern parade in City Park, and they actually had candles in them. I mean, it was fire. Now it's like, what a word, you know. You wouldn't be able to do that now, I would guess. They probably have the fake candles in, but we actually carried the lighted candles.
Yeah, and just to fast forward to the present, I serve on the Reading Recreation Commission, have been since its inception. We still have the lantern parade. You're right, we don't use candles anymore, but thanks to the leadership of Heather and Daphne Clare, what happens is every year, each of the playgrounds puts together, based on the theme, they put together banners, they design their lanterns, and they come to City Park, and they have activities where they play games and such. And in fact, the logo for the Reading Recreation Commission is a lantern based on that tradition.
How about that?
So,
but it was just so special. It was just so special.
And we knew it was special. And so when we started the Reading Recreation Commission, we wanted to pay honor to the things that were special for the people and make the connection between the past and the present.
Right.
And that's what I think this reunion's going to do.
Yeah.
I think so, too. Right. People are really talking about it and excited about it.
Yeah, and one of the things that impressed me, you know, Tom let me know through correspondence that he was planning it. The first planning meeting, now this is just a planning meeting. What do we have, 70 people?
Nearly 70 people, right.
Okay, including my neighbor, who's one of the oldest residents of East Reading, Joni Eppenstein. Okay, and I was real honored the last time, because my parents had passed, when I got sworn in as a city council person, Joan held the Bible for me.
Oh, isn't that wonderful?
Yeah, she's like my second mom.
Yeah.
So, you know, and it's just...
She's an icon.
She's an icon. And when she went to the reunion planning meeting, she met the bridesmaids of her daughter.
Oh.
Okay, so, and I guess she was going around. So, what came out of that first planning meeting?
Well, a strong desire to do more, and we planned a second meeting, and you were at the second meeting as well, and we had almost 50 people for that, and we had roughly half of the same people that were at the first one, but we had about another half that were new. And I can tell you that we have a mailing list now with names and addresses of people who either live there now or live there of almost 600 people. So that's... I think that's tremendous.
Okay, so a little bit, I know you can't go into too much detail about the reunion, the date, what's going to happen on September 16th?
Well,
well, we hope a lot of people are coming, that's for sure.
Yeah, and I know the Liederkranz, you know, obviously it hosts the Oktoberfest, it has a lot of room up there.
It is equipped to handle a large crowd, which I think was one of the selling points when we had gone up to see it. The parking is right there on the property, they have handicap accessible, they have a covered pavilion, which seats like 350 people, they have like a beer garden, it really seemed to be best suited for our needs because we don't know how many people are going to be showing up.
I have to give credit to Pat and the other people who are on the site selection committee too because they spent a half a day looking at various sites. And not that the other sites weren't good, but when we looked at the total picture and what fit best for East Reading, seemed to be the ticket.
And it's in East, Liederkranz is in basically East Reading. Mm-hmm. You can see the pagoda. Mm-hmm. It's right there.
That's when you know you're home, when you can see the pagoda.
You know, everybody, let's face it, everybody trekked up the mountain to go to the pagoda, and you know, it was one of the places.
Well, Rick, so tell me, do you walk from your home up the mountain all the way up to the pagoda?
We did, sure.
Okay.
And up the motorcycle climb. Back of the cemetery.
Mountains.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, my dad walked Neversink Mountain as much, you know, took us up Neversink Mountain as much to see the old ruins and explain the ruins.
Yeah, and let's talk a little bit about that, walking up Neversink. One of the things I find with some of the young people that are on Neversink Playground is they're not as familiar with walking up into what I call the woods.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's the word I use, probably real Dutchy, but okay. And I want to be able to get them more excited. But what are some of the iconic places that are up on Neversink Mountain?
Wow. You know, as kids, he would show us that there used to be around 17th or 18th Street, there was a fountain, a spring. And we always stopped at the spring. And, you know, he taught us how to hold our hands in a cup and drink the spring water.
Okay.
And there was a cup there, but we weren't allowed to use the cup. We had to use our
hands. And that worked.
And there was a couple of old ruins where the buildings had burned down.
Mm-hmm.
I guess they were like health centers way back, like they used to have on Galen
Tuberculosis.
Hall.
Yeah,
right.
Mineral Springs, and there were hotels that were up there.
That's exactly right. But they were almost all made out of wood.
Right. Mm-hmm. So they're all gone. The pagoda is the only thing that's left of everything that was built back in the early part of the 19th century.
Well, you still do have Mineral Spring Park, which is nice.
Right, exactly.
And Pandora Park.
Right.
And that's also very nice, too.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And maybe let's talk a little bit more about Neversink, then we'll switch over to the other side of Perkiomen.
Okay.
To Pandora. So one of the ruins that you can see is from the incline that used to go up the side of the hill.
Okay.
Okay, that there used to be a tram that ran from the base. Now, what's really great now is the Berks Nature owns all that land, and they put in trailheads and such.
Oh, wonderful.
So it's really, it's like we have great things building on what was in the past. The place that has stayed the same as long as I've lived where I have is the quarry, though.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Did you folks visit the quarry when you were kids?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what went on up there? Maybe I shouldn't ask.
No.
Can't tell you everything.
We were with my dad.
Okay.
Nothing went on up there. We would hike, like on a Saturday afternoon. You know, we would just, he liked walking. He liked to get out in nature and, you know, all the kids trekked up through the woods. That's and you know he would show us the places, but we never went there in the evening.
Yeah. And we didn't have cell phones. We didn't have computers.
Right. Exactly to distract you.
Yeah, and so and we didn't have a lot of money either. So so we made our own fun.
That's exactly right.
And it was a cool place to go.
Oh yeah,
literally cool.
Yes, literally cool.
And I have to tell you, one of the things that I really like about it, I like to be able to make jams and such. There are so many raspberry bushes up on the hills there that I can collect raspberries and make my raspberry jam, or, you know, now I make infusion with water, that kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
So it's amazing the things you find. A lot of sassafras trees.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And if you walk all the way to the top of Neversink and look down, you can then see the Schuylkill River on the other side of the mountain.
Yes.
Now, I think the only thing that probably changed since you folks lived in that area is Judge Eshelman at one point built the house that was on top of the hill.
Right. Mm-hmm.
If you actually go and you camp because it's private property to the end there, it's the same level as the pagoda. So when you're looking across the valley, you can see, you know, you're just as high on Neversink. Maybe not quite as high, but you see that. So, anything else you can remember as memories playing in that area, things that were fun for you?
Not well, of course, going to the candy stores, and there was one on 14th and a half on Fairview, and then there was one at 15th and a half on Cotton Street, and we always, I shouldn't say always, but we usually went to Goulden's Candy Store, which was on 15th and a half Street.
Okay.
Lovely lady. She always was like a little grandmothery kind of person, and, you know, she'd pick out one candy of here and, you know, the penny candy. Well,
oh,
you wanted
fun.
One of those and one of those and one of those, you know, because you got a whole nickel and you had five pieces of candy and some of them were two for a penny.
And it would take you 20 minutes to pick out
That's
10
exactly
pieces of candy, right? And the people were patient with us. But
yes, they were.
There was a dirt lot between Cotton and Muhlenberg at Chapel Terrace, and we made that our own playground. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a city-sanctioned playground, but and Andrea Gajewski, who's treasurer of our group, mm-hmm. played softball there with me, would you believe, and a bunch of other people. I mean, we just have pickup games there. Mm-hmm. And at the synagogue on Perkiomen Avenue, which was formerly where the Olivets was, we used to play football on that lot.
That's not a very big lot.
No, but hey, when you don't have many choices, you take what you can get. Uh-huh. So we had that, and then I remember St. Mary's had their carnivals at 12th and Muhlenberg Street.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And that was always a big thing. And Pandora, at one time, on the 4th of July, would have fireworks.
Yes.
Right, I remember that.
Mm-hmm. And that was a big deal because I remember afterwards it would get so crowded that cars were bumper to bumper on Cotton Street and moved inch by inch.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's how attractive that was. And of course, Pandora at one time was an amusement park.
Yeah.
A personal memory that I have is there was a store at 13th and Spruce called Whitco Daily Market. I had my first job there delivering groceries for $6 a week. But I loved it. But that's the kind of thing, too. I don't know if it's still this way, but if you wanted to work, you could find the girls got babysitting jobs.
Oh, yes.
The guys could cut grass or deliver groceries. Mm-hmm. And Jimmy's Meat Market down on South 9th
mm-hmm.
Street.
Mm-hmm.
I remember the same thing there. Jack Finelli had a place at Wonder and Chestnut,
mm-hmm.
and it's still a grocery store. I think it's Chinese or Vietnamese now, but it really was a people, family-oriented area.
Right.
Yeah, and Jimmy's is still going strong,
mm-hmm.
okay? A lot of real good produce there,
mm-hmm.
and that's the one thing I like about having the corner grocery stores.
Right.
I wish someone would carry a little more produce. Konopaski's, of course, closed.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's, just a regular bodega grocery store now, mm-hmm. but there's still good things there.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, Konopaski's is one of the sponsors for our East Reading reunion, so we're happy to have their help.
Yeah.
And I chose to help the sponsor too, so.
And thank you very much, yes.
I mean, the whole area means so much to me. And when I got married, my husband's grandparents grew up on Cotton Street. And so he was sort of attuned to the area. When the house that we live in now, the Simsicks owned it, and that went up for sale.
Oh, Bill Simsick, yeah. Now I remember Bill.
Yeah, okay, so that's, how I got the connection. But the one thing that I really liked when I moved into the house is there was a playground across the street.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, it was Neversink Playground. Now, I know it went through a lot of transitions, but if you could show the picture, the colored photo.
I'm not the Neversink Playground.
Okay, now what's really interesting with this picture, and it's sort of hard to pick out, but one of the classic designs for Neversink Playground were stone bleachers. And I'm not sure, they were probably built during the Conservation Corps era in the 30s.
Mm-hmm.
They're still in great shape. The bleachers are, they're sort of unusual. Do you remember sitting there watching games and stuff?
Yes. You always watch the baseball games from sitting on those stone bleachers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But there's some things that aren't as good with the playground. And I think it's because of how old it is.
Yeah.
I think one of the problems that we're having, and I've emphasized this with the mayor, with the police, is we have people that are now riding what they call all-terrain vehicles, unlicensed motorcycles. They tear through the ball field. So when there's kids there, it's not safe anymore. I've seen kids almost get hit a number of times. Then they take circles, they run down Fairview Street, they do wheelies and everything, even on Perkiomen, Cotton. We have to put an end to this.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I want to be able to ask you guys' support, former residents, that we need to get the word out that this is not acceptable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And whatever we need to do, working with enforcement, because I want our kids to have safe places to play.
The playgrounds need to be preserved.
Yes.
Right. The other challenging part, can you bring that picture back up again quick? I'm sorry. Okay, if you look at the macadamed area there, those used to be steps.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, do you remember having steps that went from one level? Because this playground's on a very steep hill.
Yes.
Ever since I've lived in East Reading, those steps every year get more and more deteriorated to the point that they probably should have yellow tape around them. They're that dangerous for the young people. Now, I know that the city, and I've heard the mayor talk about how he's investing in fixing up playgrounds Fortunately, he's never come to talk to me about what's needed over in Neversink, but I'm making my voice heard now tonight, Mayor.
Good.
Okay, because we need to have that safe.
Yeah.
If we're going to be putting up volleyball nets and we're going to be fixing up the backboards, we need to make sure that the actual terrain on these playgrounds are safe for the children.
And sure. I don't know that any other playground in Reading has that kind of stonework. I mean, it's
right.
beautiful stonework.
It's gorgeous, mm-hmm. yeah.
It looks like it was also maybe done by the same people who might have done the wall around the pagoda.
Yeah.
Yeah, could be. Well, I'm not sure who all the stonemasons are, and some mm-hmm. of them are hard to find now, but there's
right.
so much stonework and needs to be repaired. I was just going back along Glen Road that takes you back from the viaduct to Hill Road. Someone hit one of those stone walls.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I know that, Tom, we can talk about this in a few minutes, the time you spent as far as getting the stone walls. But what if you look at the stone walls on Neversink, fortunately through the Reading Recreation Commission and volunteers from Alvernia University, they took down a lot of the growth that was there that made it so you couldn't walk on those walls.
So I
see the kids running up and down,
sure.
you know, they're having fun. Fortunately, they haven't gotten into the idea of sitting there to watch the ball games.
Mm.
That's, you know, not something they're used to doing. But mm-hmm. there's always at least 24 children, families up on that playground every night. I thank Public Works. They fix the lights there so mm-hmm. that it's safer. But we know that a lot of these playgrounds are going to need more work invested in
well,
them.
They used to have a party up there as well. You know, they used to have these festivals, and
right.
they used to have a festival up there as well.
Yeah. The only thing that happens now there during the summer, thank goodness to the people from Fairview Mennonite Church, they invest a lot in there. They have great picnics there over the summertime
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and such, so you can see some of that activity, but not as much organized. There's not a playground association there,
okay.
and the playground isn't manned the way it used to be. There's
okay.
no playground leaders or anything.
That's a shame, really.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, Pandora is a little bit different. Can you tell me the memories of that park?
That was pretty far for us to go.
Oh, so you didn't
but
walk
we, for... We would go to the pool.
Yes, we mm-hmm. know about the other name for the pool.
The waiting pool.
Yes,
exactly right.
And,
the waiting pool, and they
AKA.
Had this nice thing in the middle that always shot the water.
Yeah.
And that's where everybody went because it was the only water in the area other than the fire hydrants.
And it was before the East Reading Pool.
That's exactly right. It was
yeah.
before the East Reading Pool.
Yeah. And just a little bit about what's happening to that pool. There was some grants that were secured to be able to rebuild that pool. I have to check to see because that's been going on a couple years now.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen any changes happen to it. And one of the things I do for my own self, you know, to be able to keep fit is I take walks where I start at my home at 15th and Fairview,
uh-huh.
walk all the way down to 22nd Street, up across the viaduct, sometimes go under the viaduct and come back and around.
Mm-hmm.
And then I walk in the alleys in between so I get a chance of seeing what's actually happening in the neighborhood.
Right, right.
And there's a lady by the name of Sheila, and I can't remember her last name right now, who I know has been pushing to do something with that. Now, what's happened? You know better than I.
Yeah, actually, with the pool situation,
okay. With East Reading Pool.
With East Reading, when the people that operated it as a private pool couldn't continue to do that, the city's looking at working together with the school district to buy it. There's a lot of structural issues that need to be looked at.
Mm-hmm. And the pipes underneath.
Yeah, and it may, I don't think the movement is to make it back into a pool just because the expense, but we were talking about having a spray park, something like that, some other options. And I'm advocating the folks in that area of the city deserve to have something. Someone said to me once, well, we could do something in Hillside and people can use it. I said, no. I said, people don't even want to cross Perkiomen Avenue.
Sure.
Okay, it's not right. safe for the children to have to go that distance. With the number of children that we have living in that east side of Reading, we need to have something right there for them. And I think you made the point. You stayed, you know,
right.
on your own
you
side.
You stayed in your own neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Right. And that's what's strong about our cities is neighborhoods, so we have to respect that part of it.
At one time, that pool used to get packed.
Oh, my goodness.
It was packed when I moved in there. I mean, first of all, I'd always have music all the time during the summertime. There were swim meets, a lot of, you know, parties and such.
Well, they used to have shows, too.
Sure.
The swimming
meets.
Shows.
Yeah, swim
they
meets,
used
yes.
to have swimming shows.
Right. And I think what happened, you see this all across, not only in Reading, but across the country, really, pools are just something that are from a bygone era.
Mm-hmm.
Northwest is gone. I think College Heights is the only pool that's open yet in the city as far as an outdoor pool. And of course, Schlegel's is run by the Reading Recreation Commission. Mm-hmm. Can't forget that, and our dedicated workers that do Schlegel's. So we do have Schlegel's. It, fortunately, it's on the other side of Binghamton Street, so it's harder for some children to get to.
Well, and the sad thing is, and I know you're well aware of this, Marcia, and I don't want to sound political tonight, but because of the way the city raises its revenue through property taxes, it's hard to keep up with expenses.
Mm-hmm, sure.
So there needs to be a change, and unfortunately that's going to take action by the legislature.
Yeah.
And that's overdue, in my opinion.
Yeah, and one of the things that we're doing now, when you look at the financial end of it, is we've set aside a certain money for capital improvements. Mm-hmm. And indeed, it's been recognized that our parks and playgrounds haven't been getting the attention they need for years. So we're looking at how to make that improve, but it's not going to be something that's going to happen in 1 year, and we need to prioritize. And being on the Reading Recreation Commission, I want to be able to work with my fellow commission members to say, what are the priorities? What needs to be done?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Now, a lot of good work's been done in City Park, and that, you know, the benches and such were replaced. That's been rebuilt, but it still requires a lot of maintenance. Mm-hmm. A lot of work's been done around the Memorial Grove. So there's great areas to be able to look at. One of the things that we started talking about a little bit about the walls, and I think you know a little bit about that, Tom, all the beautiful walls, the stone walls that were built around Reading during the Depression, and a lot of them have become in a state of
disrepair.
Yeah. You were involved in that somewhat?
Yeah, as commissioner, one of the things that I did was recognize that Skyline Drive really is a tremendous asset for the city and for the county. Mm-hmm. And what we did is we got Lower Alsace Township, the city, and the county. All four entities put money in, and together we contracted to have a stonemason go up there. And a lot of those, not nearly enough, but there's a pretty substantial amount of those walls that were fixed as a result of that. But again, you know, not nearly enough.
I mean, when you look at, there's probably tens of miles of roads that need to be fixed up. And that leads me to something that I'm not sure how much either of you are aware of, but we have started now the Mount Penn Preserve, which is a collaborative effort between multiple municipalities, Lower Alsace, Alsace, Mount Penn, the City of Reading, and we're looking at preserving, protecting, and building on the assets that we have in the Mount Penn area.
Oh, good.
So part of that is a strategic plan. If you want to go on the County of Berks website, there's a plan for how people who had input envisioned that mountain. And as of this month, we're also working in a more formal way through something that's called a Council of Governments, or COG, where we all have representation. I'll be representing the city together with Linda Keller on the COG, and then different people are appointed from the different municipalities, and we'll be looking at issues like policing, safety, all of those kind of things.
Yeah.
And that really is I think, the wave of the future. You need to pool resources to get things done because resources are so scarce, and because of the problem with taxation that we talked about a minute ago, you need to pool money together to get things done.
Right,
yeah.
These projects are expensive.
Yeah, I mean, they are multi-million-dollar projects that we're looking at. And our most precious pagoda has always had money invested in it, but at least every 20 years it needs to be repainted, the roofing, the tile.
The lights.
The good news, and thanks to former Mayor McMahon and the work that he did, we were able to replace the flagpole and now have a permanent flagpole that's solar lit there, and the American flag is always flying over the city of Reading. Now, what's challenging about that flag ends up getting ripped up because of the wind, so it needs to be replaced at least once a month.
And I remember back in the early 80s, the city appropriated money through community development dollars to replace those lights. Uh-huh. Now, whether anything's been done with that since, but I commend the city for doing what you do to keep that structure alive, because that's really the symbol of Reading, I think, for a lot of people.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, and that's one of the, again, we need to be able to plan and budget for that and know there's costs. And I think the other thing is we need to look at private partnerships.
Mm-hmm.
I know when I was showing you the picture of the condition of the steps, you had some thoughts for that, Tom.
Yeah, maybe there's a way to, and that was just kind of a knee-jerk reaction, but I think it's worth exploring. Maybe doing some fundraisers to try to raise money to do things and maybe you target it for one thing at a time, like Never Sink Playground.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's a committee that maybe makes decisions on what work is to be done, and then you raise money to get the funds you need to accomplish those projects. And if you'd like my help, I'd be happy to help you.
Yeah, well, I really appreciate that. And I think people take greater ownership when they have something to do. If someone just comes in and does it for them, okay, it's sort of not them, and then that person goes away, and then things get in disrepair. I'd rather have people form some type of playground association and work, you know.
They feel like they have an ownership interest in it. Like, hey, I helped to make that happen.
Mm-hmm.
And what I've noticed now, and I think the good thing that's been happening in the neighborhood is people are starting to take more ownership. For instance, for a long time, when it snowed, my husband and I were always shoveling on our own. Now we're starting to have young people come to our door, can I help to shovel, miss, you know, really cooperation.
Mm-hmm.
You're seeing people that actually have snow removal equipment that they actually will start to plow the streets at the top of the hill.
Let me talk to you about that.
How did you clean up the snow when you guys lived in East Reading?
Everybody got together and shoveled the streets out.
Uh-huh.
I mean, we would have the men in the, nobody could move because everybody was snowed in, and there were some mighty big snowfalls.
Oh yeah.
And the men would just get together and they would go down the street, and the women and the kids would go down the pavements, and everybody just pitched in.
Mm-hmm. And
whole neighborhood, because otherwise nobody moved.
And the kids, we loved it because we used to go out and we'd go door to door and say, would you like your sidewalk shoveled?
Mm-hmm.
And you could make three, five, sometimes if it was a big corner property, as much as $10.
Mm-hmm.
It was great. I mean, I loved it because at the end of the day, I'd go home with a pocket full of money.
Yeah. So that's what we want to encourage, that kind of ownership of your neighborhood, that part of making. One of the things I haven't seen happen as much, and it's somewhat distressing, is people aren't sweeping in front of their properties.
Mm-hmm.
And I know when I moved in the neighborhood, there was always, everyone was always out there sweeping.
Mm-hmm.
Now I see the people and there's a lot of trash, a lot of those plastic bottles, which...
That's unfortunate.
Yeah. So we just need to be working on that end of it. But I think if it started somewhere, but I do believe if we fix up the playground and people see that someone else cares, they're going to be willing to help out to
it'll
do the cleanup.
Yeah.
It was just pride in your own home as well. Mm-hmm. I mean, the pavement out front, even the gutter was cleaned.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you just didn't have that.
Let me ask you about the alleys. How did you folks take care of the alleys? Because I know the mayor's interested in repairing all the alleys.
Everybody took care of their section.
Yeah, their own.
And we used the alleys a lot.
Mm-hmm. And it was kind of our own.
Yeah.
That was our own.
We would bicycle down the alley, we'd sled down the alley, and there was an empty lot behind us. Now it's a parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
But we used to come down off the lot and down through the alley all the way down, and at the bottom of the hill, Cotton Street, you know, it was a cross alley. And
I know which one you're talking about. Yeah.
It's a
cement alley.
Yes, it's a cement alley. And sometimes you didn't always stop or turn in time. And, you know, that fence, that fence at the bottom of the hill really sometimes got beat.
And the other thing the boys did, I remember, we used to race model cars down the alleys.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an alley I particularly remember between Muhlenberg and Cotton off of 14th Street. It's a pretty steep alley. But we'd always clean it up because it was in our interest to do that, because we didn't want dirt there, because we wanted to race these cars and not have them have any interference. And it was neat. I mean, and sometimes we'd have 15 kids there racing model cars. Right. It was just something that we'd do on our own. We try to make our own fun.
Sure.
Yeah, and you know, it's interesting when you talk about racing those little cars, little with the Blue Mountain Racing Association. Mm-hmm. They go out to 3rd and Spruce with the Recreation Commission, and all the young people there create their own little cars, and they have a ramp that they race down on.
There you go. Okay. Same idea.
Yeah, and let me ask you, was the Duray Hill Climb, was that in existence?
Oh, yes. Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Was that something that a lot of the neighborhood kids would go out and...
We our neighborhood didn't go.
We didn't.
And I always wondered that, because I see so many people come into the hill climb, but I don't see a lot of young people. What we want to do now is the young men that won the race at the Reading Recreation Commission, we want to be able to have them be able to come out to the hill climb so they can see what the real cars look like.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And then the other thing was sledding down the hills.
I mean, yes. They used to close, what was it, 17th Street, 17th Street.
I hope I don't get in trouble for saying this, but some people used to call those hills the Polish Alps.
Yeah, I heard that already.
and we would literally sled down those hills, and you could really get a fast sled ride down those hills.
Uh-huh. Yep.
And what I get concerned now is I see people not being respectful of safety, so they'll take, for instance, those mini bikes, and they'll go down the hill, but they won't stop at the stop sign. They'll just ride straight through. Mm-hmm. And we have to look at a way that we can help people understand that it's not only their lives that are at risk, there's other people.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Did you ever feel that when you were sledding, that maybe you were taking a little bit of a more of a risk that you...
Particularly.
Well, they were blocked off, though. The street was blockaded at the top.
Oh, so they let that...
Yeah, okay. It was blockaded there at the viaduct, and you just came all the way down that hill, and it was blocked off at Cotton. Cars were not allowed to go back and forth there. Mm-hmm. That street was totally blocked off.
And cars probably would have had a tough time negotiating that anyway.
That anyway.
So did you have the public works from the city come and plow everything for you? Or it sounds like you were digging out on your own.
Well, we were digging out on our own, but I think the blocking, somebody from the city did. I don't know. But
did they ever come with snow plows, though, and clean off the hills for you?
Yeah, but...
Well, we were sort of the last...
Get done.
You know, it was... Just the neighborhood, you know, it was just the neighborhood, so.
Eventually they came.
Yeah. They did Cotton Street more than the side streets.
That was the
main street.
Bus
That's
run.
Exactly
and the,
right.
And the bus run, yeah.
And I really feel for the plow drivers when they have to come down these half streets now and try to plow them, and they do like 15th and a half street, and I'm thinking, how in the world do they get up and down?
Exactly right.
So what do you look forward to now? We have the reunion coming up in another couple months. Do you see any more planning meetings, people getting together before the reunion, or what do you see leading up to that?
Well, we do have committees set up. As I said, Pat and others were very instrumental in the site selection. I think did an excellent job, and I want to thank you again, Pat,
for your
work and your sister and a number of other people. But we also have a history committee, and that committee is going to be looking at the history of East Reading. And we're going to ask them, and there's a couple ways to do it. And one way would be to have members make a brief report, like a 5 or 10 minute report, and then at another time do another 5 or 10 minute report. Maybe there's one on the East Reading Pool, maybe there's one on Pandora, different places that are of interest. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing we're doing is we're going to have an entertainment committee putting together some music for us, and of course, Ted Robidas, who's also known as Ted Roberts, who was on WRFY and is married into the Konopelski family, has graciously agreed to be a disc jockey for us at no charge.
Are we going to have Polish music, Tom?
A mixture.
A mixture, okay.
A mixture. A little bit of Polish music, but I think more probably generic kinds of stuff, but from the various decades, because we have people who are older, like myself, and then, of course, we as you say, it's so important to get the young people involved. We need to...
I think the neighborhoods also were very, very diverse. Mm-hmm. It wasn't just we didn't live in a Polish neighborhood.
Right.
I mean, our next door neighbor, one was Italian, the other side was Scotch.
Mm-hmm.
Across the street, there were, you know, the Germans were across the street. You know, we had Irish. There were
Black families.
That's exactly right. You know, it was a very diverse neighborhood.
The Gilmore,
but we all got along.
Gilmore family from South 18th Street. Almost everybody knew the Gilmores.
Right. Sure.
And you know, we all played together as kids. And they were a nice, very nice family. And a couple of them went on to be very successful in sports.
Mm-hmm. Right. And one of them, I think, works for the city right now. We have
Dan, I believe, right?
Yeah, Danny, yeah. So, and what I've seen since I've moved in, I think there were more of the Polish folks and Italian and stuff. Now we continue to have that diversity. We have Romanian families, mm-hmm. A lot of folks from the Dominican, mm-hmm. Puerto Rico, Mexico.
And you know what? They've started up, as you said, the bodegas. But in a way, you know, that's in a lot of ways a continuation of those corner stores.
Right. Yeah, there have always been corner stores on every block, and that's what makes the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. I have to say to you, from my background, my grandmother had a corner store in Harrisburg, and I remember sitting in the window of the store and also mm-hmm. looking at the candy. Mm-hmm. My uncle had Goodman Vending Service, so there was a lot of, you know, family-owned businesses that were part of my heritage, too. So I really respect the people that are operating the bodegas and how hard that is.
Oh, yes.
By the way, we have to mention 11th and Muhlenberg was the famous location of Ice and Bice's store, more, how should I say, in a friendly way known as Icy Bice's. Mm-hmm. Harry Ice and Bice, the grandson of the original Harry Ice and Bice, is working on our site selection mm-hmm. committee. In fact, he's chairing it.
Right.
So we're happy to, you know, we're trying to get people of all ages. And the one thing that maybe we've fallen down on a little bit is getting the younger people involved. So we're working on that. But we need help. So, folks, if you're listening, we want to keep the tradition of East Reading alive. So please, if you know some young people, have them give us a call and either get involved or at least come to the reunion, see what that's about, and go from there.
Well, you have a Facebook page, right?
We do, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's East Reading Reunion 2018.
Okay.
And Sandy Hummel, who is co-chairing this activity, put that together, and that's been very successful. We've had, in the space of a few months, we've had several hundred people come to that Facebook site.
Yeah, and I know I'm coming to the meetings. I'm one of the few people that still lives in the neighborhood. Mm-hmm. But what could I do to help to reach out to the neighbors to let them know about the reunion?
Well, if there's any way you can get word to them, that's uh-huh. that's and get us names and addresses so we can add them to the mailing list.
Okay.
Because we want to invite them, but we can't if we don't know about them. And that's the same with the viewers too. And we appreciate that, Marcia, very much. But I'd like to extend that invitation to the viewers as well. If either you have a relative of any age, particularly younger folks, get that information to us, and we're going to show some phone numbers at the end that you can call to give us a contact.
Okay. Now, have you had an opportunity to go through the neighborhood recently? Have you walked around, visited some of your old haunts?
Not really. I haven't been through. I live on the other end of town. Uh-huh. I'm at the very end of Spring Township.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Actually, my house is separated between Berks County and Lancaster County.
Okay.
The county line goes right through the house. So it's at least a 35-minute drive to get to where I used to live.
Right. Yeah.
And I just don't go that direction. So I haven't been through that way for a while.
How about you, Tom?
I go to Tax on a Sunday frequently because mm-hmm. they have a special deal where you can get a large cheesesteak sandwich for the price of a small cheesesteak. And that's still the best cheesesteak in Berks County, in my opinion.
Yes.
And I know when we were talking before the show, there was something that you mentioned that I know is a concern of mine, things that you've seen that changed and weren't so good about the neighborhood.
One of the things that I think is really pathetic, and I know that's a strong word to use, but I think it is pathetic, and that's that UGI made the decision to put those gas meters and gas lines in front of properties. To me, that does nothing to improve the image of the area and only detracts from it. And I think it's really unfortunate.
Yeah, and in fact, the city is in litigation with UGI.
Mm-hmm. But some of it happened before, I guess, you started the litigation. You didn't really know about it.
Well, what was, first of all, we weren't informed about it when it happened. It started to happen, and then they were tearing up Cotton Street. So the most we were able to get out of UGI at that point was to pay for the repaving of Cotton Street.
Mm-hmm.
However, what I have found is that they are so close to the curbs that it makes it unsafe. It's unsightly, as you said, but I'm really concerned about the public safety part of it. And it's hard to have people have pride in their neighborhoods when a utility comes and disregards the quality of the neighborhood and just puts in, and they say they have a reason for doing it, and I've seen them in other communities, but it just feels like we're being taken over by the public utilities without any consideration for the neighborhoods.
Perfect example I can give is I lived at 1215 Cotton Street. That house still has a brick sidewalk, but it has an ugly gas meter right in front of the front window. Uh-huh. I think it looks like hell.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
I'm sorry.
Those words have been used at council meetings, believe me. I'm talking about it, so yeah. I don't know that they have any censors on the show, but thank you for your honest opinion.
I'm sorry, that's the way I feel. Yeah.
And, you know, I have tried, and I feel like it's like David and Goliath when you're trying to fight them. So what is being recommended is that we work together with some of the other municipalities that are being affected. It's not only Reading's issue, and there will be strength in numbers. So,
and I commend you, Marcia. You've really been an advocate for that part of town, and Southeast Reading is fortunate to have you there. Yeah. I don't think you see this as a job to do. You view it as a mission or a commitment.
Right, right. And that's why, you know, I will always be able to advocate if I see things that are not going right. Mm-hmm. Whatever, I've worked with three different mayors now. I've always, you know, expressed it. I've been really blessed to be able to represent East Reading, where we have the pagoda. Mm-hmm. And it just keeps me going to be able to look at what we can do to continue to improve.
But it's your neighborhood as well.
Oh, yeah.
That's right. It's Marcia, your neighborhood.
And Marcia comes forward on her own to do things. Like, we extended the invitation, and immediately she accepted. She was at both meetings, and she's talking about even doing some sort of a citation from the city. Yeah. And we're just grateful. This reunion can't happen because of a few people. It has to be everybody. Mm-hmm. And that's why we're so grateful that everybody's willing to help. And please, if you're watching tonight and you're not involved, take down the phone number at the end of the show. Get in touch with us. Be a part of this. Who knows? This may only happen once. It's never happened before.
Mm-hmm. And I think what's important, it shows you that neighborhoods are really precious to people. Mm-hmm. They take pride in where they've come from.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of the younger people that live in the area now call it, the south part of the city. They don't refer to it as East Reading. Mm-hmm. I continue to use that term because that's what I learned from, you know, living in that neighborhood. I feel somewhat saddened that, for instance, we are challenged by the East Reading pool. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I had my wish list of things that I would like to see, it would be that pool would be revived, that, you know, all the parks would be back to their former glory, but we're just limited in the money that we can do.
Right,
so sometimes we have to use our own resources.
Well, there's a huge wish list, but you can probably bring that into reality and do some of those things.
Right.
Maybe can't do everything. Maybe can't put a log flume in Pandora Park like there was back in the early part of last century. But like you say, never sink. Mm-hmm. You can probably do some things to make that a much better place and restore it to what it was.
And Mineral Spring Park, and we didn't talk about that, but that is one of the most beautiful hidden treasures with all the stonework there.
Oh, yes.
There's been a transition. Of course, the East Ends Club isn't in there anymore, but we have to find a good use for that building. It's around over 200 years old. Mm-hmm. What I find very exciting, though, is there's community groups that are getting up and running, like the Hessian Camp Community Council. Those folks are so dynamic, and they really advocate. They want to have a quiet, safe neighborhood to live in, and you're going to be hearing their voices coming up in future council meetings because they have some concerns about things that are going on up at the pagoda. Mm-hmm. They don't want that to be in any way disrespected. It's not there for a party zone, for people to be drinking beer and
And you took action to put an end to that, I believe, by putting some limit on the hours that people can be up there.
And I think we need to put some stronger limits on it, and we need to have policing up there, too. And that's why...
But you're taking steps.
Yeah, definitely. I'm not going to allow that. One of my concerns, and what happens every year, is the fireworks. Were there a lot of fireworks when you were... where people were shooting off their own in the neighborhood?
Yes. Okay. Yes. Also, there were organized fireworks like Pandora.
Oh, yes. Yes.
There
were a lot of organized fireworks.
Yeah, when we talked about this before, that when Pandora had fireworks on the 4th of July, cars were bumper to bumper on Cotton Street, and they would inch down Cotton Street, and there was traffic jam for an hour or more.
Those were the out-of-towners.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the people who lived there
walked. Yeah.
walked to Pandora.
And now what's happened with Pennsylvania making... more and more fireworks legal, Okay, people are buying them on their own, mm-hmm. and then they're going up to the pagoda, shooting them off. Unfortunately, a couple years ago, there was a brush fire down below. Oh. Yeah. Okay, and this is what was most disgraceful, mm-hmm. is that people, the firefighters were down there trying to fight. They were shooting off fireworks into the firefighters where they were trying to
do it.
So we have to have a different attitude, yeah. and mm-hmm. I want to be able to work with any group that wants to use the mountain to be able to respect it for what it is, but it's not there for drinking, it's not there for drugging, it's there to respect the natural beauty.
Right. And you know, we would all have sparklers. Everybody has sparklers.
Oh, yeah. That's the kind of thing.
That in your backyard.
Sure. Uh-huh.
So that's the, you know, in communicating and working with the police department, with the mayor, is that let's talk about what our shared vision is for the mountain and mm-hmm. be able to say you can't be disrespectful. Now, I know even when I moved into where I'm on Never Sink, the quarry was a place that people drank. Mm-hmm. I don't know whether that was the case when you lived up there.
Yes.
But now we need to be able to turn it around. It's just not safe.
Mm-hmm. But even back then, I think people were maybe a little more respectful of it than sometimes they are now with trash, particularly. Mm-hmm. People
you carried in, you carried out.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, you took care of it.
That's a good point. You don't leave it.
Right.
Okay, we're going to be wrapping up in a few minutes, so I wanted to be able to, even though we had the numbers up on the screen, if you could just read them off, Tom, as far as who needs to contact who at what numbers.
Sure. The East Reading reunion is on Sunday, September 16th from noon to 6 p.m., and it's at the Liederkranz, 143 Spook Lane, Reading, Pennsylvania. And you can call either, and you can call anybody in the committee, but we don't have everybody's number listed, but you can call me at 610-698-8731, or Sandy Lubas Hummel, who, by the way, grew up on Muhlenberg Street and then moved to South 19th, at 610-207-7065. And we really would welcome any help, and the biggest thing is identifying people to come to this reunion, and people that we can add to our mailing list, because we want to keep them informed as to what's happening. And then East Reading Reunion t-shirts. We're going to do t-shirts. They're $15 each, and you can call Don Himmelreich at 484-638-8316. And we have, so far, we have, I think it's 13 sponsors for the back of the t-shirts, and that's going to help us with expenses. And the one person that I want to particularly acknowledge is Jeff Hogue, who's with Weikert Realtors,
right?
Because he's giving $1,000 to this activity to make sure it goes. He lived at 249 South 13th Street in the same apartment that my brother once lived in. So, what a small world.
Yes.
Huh? Yeah, really, that's East Reading, though.
Yeah, and interestingly enough, when I look at the deeds to my home, mm-hmm. okay, it was built in 1925. Mm-hmm. Okay, there weren't that many people that lived there. Mm-hmm. Okay, it went from one owner to the Simsicks to myself. So there have actually only been three families that have lived mm-hmm. in that home over, you know, that many years.
And an interesting fact is that former Reading Fire Chief Bill Rare's grandfather was a contractor that had to do with a building of about 200 homes, Cotton Street, Muhlenberg Street. I don't know exactly, he can tell you better, but so again, a tradition carries on.
Mm-hmm. And when you look at how these homes are constructed, mm-hmm. we have a stone foundation in our homes. They are very well put together. I refer to them, even though they are row homes, they are actually townhouses.
Mm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, they're just as quality as any townhouse you're going to find out in the suburbs, probably better construction.
Oh yes.
And so,
because you didn't hear the noise from your neighbor.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So one of the things we want to do as a city is we want to make sure that they're deconverted down to single family homes and that people can see the quality of them. I've seen a lot of people move into the neighborhood, and I want those folks to be able to join us. So the reunion we're going to be having in 2018 becomes a reunion for people as they continue to move into the neighborhood. So I want to thank...
And maybe things can be an outgrowth of it, too, like working on the Never Sink Playground, for
example.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. So I just want to thank you for all the enthusiasm, Tom, Pat, all the other people that have served on the committees.
And you.
Yep. Well, you know, I'm always committed to my neighborhood, so we're going to make it happen, and... you know, just be the foundation for greater things that are going to happen, not only in East Reading, but in all of Reading, because we'll make Reading proud. So thank you for joining us this evening.
Sure.
And we're going to be continuing to meet and move forward.
It's our East Reading, all of us.
All of us. Thank you very much.